A couple of you have come expecting Pastor Trevor Murphy this morning. The tangible look of disappointment on people's face when I told them Pastor Trevor can't be here. He's had some issues come up, but you've got me instead. And what Pastor Bill doesn't realise is that behind closed doors, sometimes we do refer to him as the bishop in these parts. And some of the leaders of the CRC movement that we're part of, when they check in at the reception and they write who they're going to see, they have been known to write things like, you know, well, what's your occasion for visiting the church, visiting, meeting with the Pope. And so these things do go on from time to time behind closed doors, but we're not big on titles, but I do think from time to time we could be a little bit more honouring with our titles and the way we speak about people, because Pastor Bill, in a lot of contexts, a bishop is someone that oversees and has a fathering influence on not just one, but a network of churches, and raising up leaders and sending them out, not just as a missionary, but as a shepherd of the leaders. And so Pastor Bill does have, in many sense, has that role of a bishop, and it's a great privilege of us as a church to be able to release him to bless our movement, but also our CFC churches as well. But no, Bill, we're not going to call you bishop. I did some casual work for the Commonwealth Bank many years ago. Has anyone here ever worked as a teller at a bank? Yeah, very, very good character building. You meet all sorts of different people at the bank. And I remember there's these guys that used to walk in, and little men, I think they were of Greek or Italian origin, like there are tend to be in the western suburbs of Adelaide. A few Greeks and Italians around the place. And they'd walk in, and they'd drive in with their rusty old cars, and they'd walk in and they'd be wearing jumpers that they look like they'd been wearing since the 1970s. And you could kind of, you know, smell the mothballs as they were walking in. And they'd hand over their passbook accounts. Does everyone remember the passbook accounts? That's the way people used to do banking. And there might be about seven of us that still use passbooks. And if you do, I actually thought they were good. I liked them. But they used to hand over their passbook accounts and ask for a balance update on their passbook accounts. And I'm thinking, oh yeah, I'm going to get a balance update. They'll have like $7 in their account because they can't afford a jumper. And they'd do the update, and I'd look down, and $1-3 million in cash. In just a regular account. Do you want to put this in a term deposit? No, just leave it here. Do you want to invest it? Do you want to invest it in shares or property? No, just leave. Do you want to see a financial planner? No, because you get incentives to upsell and to, you know, get all this sort of stuff. No, we're just going to leave it in the regular account. Nice and safe, just getting the very basic interest. And I'm thinking, wow, there's a disconnect there. If I had $3 million, oh, I'd spend it a lot better than that guy. And I wouldn't be driving that car and I wouldn't be wearing that jumper. But sometimes there can be a disconnect in life, and also in the way people value wealth. I mean, who knows what those people did with their wealth. But I think as Christians, there can be a disconnect between our beliefs and our status and our position in Christ and our experience of the everyday. For instance, just recently I met a Christian leader who was the man that planted the first church in Baghdad after the invasion of Iraq by the Allied forces. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Just like, yeah, talking to this guy, he's like, oh yeah, I planted the first church after the invasion. And I'm like, wow, that is really cool. And he's just sharing stories about ministering in that context and leading people to Christ. And, you know, they would lead people to Christ and then they would bury people. the next day, and there was literally not a family in the church that wasn't touched by tragedy in that church, and signs and wonders and power that this man experienced. And he's eventually shifted to Australia, and he's now part of our CRC movement. And he's and when I met him, I just thought, wow, I want you to come to our church. And he said, oh, I'm not much of a preacher. And I'm thinking, you could just get up and just talk like you're talking to me, and we would all be in tears, because he's an amazing man. And the thing that struck me when I'm talking to him, like, he has seen more tragedy in his life than most of us ever will, but he just had this perpetual smile on his face. And I'm like, what is with that? Isn't that true, Bill? This guy, he's just got this smile on his face, and he's just got this beautiful spirit that just exudes out of him. And I've seen that with actually some of you in this room, some of you in this room that have been through heartbreaking loss or come out of extreme conditions, or some of you have experienced incredibly tough times in refugee camps or in very difficult domestic situations here in Australia, and I see the joy of the Lord on your face. And then I meet some people like me that have had a relatively cruisy existence, and we're just sad sods. We just feel sorry for ourselves, and there can be a disconnect between our theology or our understanding of the Christian life and our position in Christ and our inheritance with Christ and our future hope and glory and our everyday experience. Isn't that just true, that there's a disconnect? Is that just true of your experience? Yes? Well, I believe that there is a disconnect between God's mission and our experience sometimes. I believe God has a mission for the world, and that is more important than the mission for your life. But the mission, God's mission for your life, is part of his mission for the world. And I think sometimes our view of God's mission for our life gets overwhelmed by a sense of pessimism that the world is going down the gurgler. But the truth is, whether you believe the world is going down the gurgler or the world is getting better is a matter of perspective. Because if I was to survey this room and I was to ask you, is world poverty increasing or decreasing? Probably it would be about 50-50. Some of you would say, yep, world poverty is increasing. And some of you would say, no, world poverty is decreasing. As far as I know, the stats on absolute poverty around the world proportionately are decreasing, and they have been for quite a while. But there does also seem to be, in a lot of parts in the world, a broadening gap between the wealth of the rich and the poverty of the poor, and so a greater inequality of riches across the world. If I was to ask you, is Australia becoming more or less racist? I think I'd get some interesting perspectives. I asked it at the 8:30 service, and I think there'd be some perspectives. I think some of us would say Australia's becoming less and less racist, but in recent years, maybe we've turned a corner and we've become a little bit more racist. Isn't it interesting the way sometimes our perspective can be so coloured by what we see with our eyes and the experiences we have in our communities? I grew up in an environment where I was convinced I wasn't a racist. And now I look back and some of the things I said and some of the jokes I said and some of the things I allowed and tolerated in my presence, I realized, man, I was a racist, naughty Christian schoolboy back in the Southern Shire. I didn't really know anyone from outside my culture. I didn't know any Muslims. As I've often said in this place, the first Aboriginal person I ever met was Joel Ken. What an experience. Joel Ken, if you know Joel Ken, he's just an incredible person. And so it's interesting that our perception is not always the full reality. Is the world becoming safer or more dangerous? I think if I was to survey this room, most of you would say it's becoming more dangerous. Well, what if you were around in Europe in the late 1930s? What about if you were in Russia or the United States during the Cold War? Do you think that that would be more dangerous than the world we live in now? People die far more from dying in cars in this country than they do from terrorism. But there's this perception the world's getting more and more unsafe. In fact, the average life expectancy just keeps on going up and up and up. Is Australia becoming more or less religious? Is the world becoming more or less religious? Is Australia becoming more and more Christian with our laws or less Christian with our laws? I think you can make a really good argument for both sides of that argument. My point is this. When you look at the news, when you look particularly at politics, it's very easy to lose heart. It's very easy to open the newspapers. It's very easy to look at our society and to lose heart. And I would say to all of you here today, do not lose heart. Whatever option there is, do not lose heart. That is not God's best for your life. And be very careful not to believe that what you see with your eyes is really seeing with God's eyes. And so many times in life we look back and we said, I was visually seeing, but I wasn't really seeing what was happening. You see, you can. There's a number of Christians in America that are despondent, and they're grieving that the fact that the church is losing ground in society and that denominations are actually shrinking. But then all over the place, there's new church movements and church planting movements that are also springing up in their place. And in fact, in our own country, there's movements and there's churches that are declining, but there's also springs of the kingdom of God all around. The question is, what are you looking at? If you're saying, God, what are you doing in the world? You could miss, if you've only lived in this city of Adelaide, you could miss that arguably the greatest move of God in the history of the world since the greatest revival of people coming into the kingdom of God is taking place not just in the book of Acts times, but today in parts of the world that don't get a lot of media play. I love this quote by Martin Luther King Jr. The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. I think this is a really important question if we're going to be people of mission. Where is the future of the world going? Habakkuk 2:14 says this, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Isn't that good to know that no matter what happens in your circumstance, no matter what happens with wars or rumors of wars, no matter what happens in your marriage, no matter what happens in your community, no matter what happens in this local church, there is a future where the glory and the presence and the power and the peace and the righteousness and the justice of God is going to cover the world. Isn't that good to know? Isn't that a good picture of the future? You see, vision is a picture of the future that produces passion in today. And so I wonder, what's your vision for the future? Is your vision for the future one of nuclear holocaust? Is your vision for the future of a world with more and more division? Is your vision for the future the church becoming less and less important in society? Or is your vision for the future one where the glory and the presence and the power of God covers the earth? I love this picture in Isaiah 61. It's a scripture that Jesus quotes in Luke's Gospel chapter 4. And it says, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. Isn't that good? What's God about in the world? What is God doing now? He is binding up the brokenhearted. That's where God is at work. To proclaim freedom to the captives. Wherever captives and those in slavery are being liberated, I believe that is the work of the kingdom of God. To release from darkness for the prisoners. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And that's where Jesus finishes when he quotes it, but it goes on to say verse 3, and provide for those who grieve in Zion. Isn't that a beautiful picture of the kingdom of God providing for those who grieve, to bestow on them a crown of beauty, instead of ashes, the oil of joy. This is a picture of the future that God is going to replace ashes with oil of joy. Instead of mourning, a garment of praise, instead of a spirit of despair. I believe where is the kingdom of God at work in our world? Wherever there is despair, and right now in the world there is despair, left, right and center on the news. But wherever there is despair, I believe that there are men and women of God, and even when there's not men and women of God, there's often the Spirit of God that goes ahead, and He is bringing praise and joy in the midst of despair. Because the Spirit of God is at work, He is bringing God's kingdom to earth as it is in heaven. They will be called oaks of righteousness and planting of the Lord for the display of His splendor. Verse 4, listen to this. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. What is God doing? What's the mission of God in the world? It's to restore the places that are devastated. when you think about what's happening in Syria right now, when you think about other parts of the world, what's God's will? What is God doing? What's the future? I'm going to tell you the guaranteed future of Syria. God is going to restore. I don't know the timeline, but God's heart is to restore. Isn't it interesting that in the start of the Bible, we start with a garden. What do we have at the end of the Bible? A city. I like that because I like cities. But we have this city. God loves building things that last. God loves restoring. He will rebuild. He will restore. And not just, that's not a physical restoration, it's a spiritual restoration. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. So we don't have to ask what God's will is. God's will is, and we read it in the end of the Bible, it's to make all things new. But it's not brand new, it's renewed. The plan of God is never to wipe out his people, it's to renew and say, I'm going to create brand new people. It's to renew his people back to their created intent. So that's where the world's going. The world, God is in charge of his world. He is King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and he has a plan to make all things new, to set things right and to restore the broken and lost things. But what about you? Where do you take place in that? Well, I think some of us lose heart with our personal mission because we're focusing on the bigness of the world out there and the bigness of the problem. But I think sometimes we lose heart because it's just really tough being a Christian. It's really tough being a Christian. Has any of you tried being a Christian and you just thought at one point of your life, it's just too hard, I give up? I've actually had this conversation. Have you ever had a chat with people about this? I think a lot of the reasons why people stop following Jesus in a country like ours is they just say it's too hard. It's just too hard to follow Jesus. And I want to suggest something good to you today is that I believe that it's impossible to be a Christian. Turn to the person next to you and say, Tim just said it's impossible to be a Christian. Because listen to this. I reckon it's practically impossible to trust God in the midst of pain, doubt, and confusion when you can't even see God. How can you trust and follow God when some days, past this confession, the little thing comes in, are my prayers going to anyone today? Or are they just hitting the roof? I mean, I don't believe you can be a man or woman of faith unless you wrestle with doubt. And you wrestle with your human limitations. It's really hard and practically impossible to love your enemies. Some of you are like, yeah, that's not hard. Well, you probably don't have many enemies yet. Just wait a few years. You'll have some enemies. And then come up to me and say, Tim, I repent of my cynicism. It's actually really hard and practically impossible to love my enemies. And those that keep on hurting me, how can I possibly love them? Forgiving someone over and over and over again. It's like, okay, Jesus, I'll forgive them once, but not twice. Well, Jesus speaks to that in the Gospels. We have to forgive people over and over. Practically impossible. Not lusting. Not looking at someone with lust in your eye. Ever. How are you going with that, church? Nervous laughter. How are you going with not loving money? How are you going with not being selfish? How are you going with not being proud? And Jesus has the audacity in the Sermon on the Mount to say, you are the light of the world. How am I the light of the world? Sometimes I don't even feel like I'm the light of my own life. My own little world. Why would Jesus, I don't feel like there's much light in me. And so it's practically impossible to be a Christian. You can try and you can try and you can try and you will generally fail. And if you try to live out the Sermon on the Mount and you try and you try and you try, Matthew chapter 5 to chapter 7, you'll realize it's impossible to be a Christian without the help of God's Spirit. Without the help of God's Spirit. But most of us, we say, okay, I theoretically have God's Spirit in me. I theologically have God's Spirit in me. I believe in God, the Holy Spirit. I believe that He is the third person of the Trinity. I believe that He lives in me, but we do not have a lived experience of the Spirit. And so we find Christianity more about striving than about overcoming. Let's have a look at John 14. Jesus replied, "Anyone who loves me will obey my teaching." How are you going with that, church? "My Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Anyone who does not love me will not obey my teaching. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. All this I have spoken while still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything I've said to you. Peace I leave with you. My heart I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid." Turn to your neighbor and say, "Do not let your hearts be troubled." And tell them, "Do not be afraid." You might want to use an Arnold Schwarzenegger accent as well. "Do not be afraid. Get in the chopper." All right. So, Jesus is saying, here and elsewhere, it's better that I go because I am sending you an advocate. Other translations say a counselor. And He is going to remind you of who your Heavenly Father is. He is going to remind you of the teachings of Jesus. He is going to remind you of everything that I've done and everything that I've said. And He will bring peace. So I'm leaving peace with you through the Holy Spirit. So wherever the Spirit of God is, there is the peace of God. Because where the presence of God is, there is the peace of God. Because why would you be scared of anything? Why would you let your hearts be troubled? And why would you be afraid if God, the God of all the universe, was with you no matter what? And so this spirit, a counselor. How many of you, I'll just talk to myself. I have seen a counselor before. But the problem with a counselor is once a month is sometimes not enough. Sometimes once a week is not enough. What about some of us need a counselor every day? Well, Jesus knew that. And He said, "I'm going to give you a counselor. And He's going to lead you. He's going to comfort you. He's going to guide you. He's going to encourage you. He's going to challenge you." But so this is already what God's doing. And wherever we go, we know that the presence and power and love of God never, ever leaves us. And the peace of God never leaves us. So because of the Spirit, the impossible task of living for Jesus becomes possible because of who we walk with and who lives in us. You see, I believe that the Holy Spirit, that there's a momentum to your life that's irresistible. And if you stop pushing against Holy Spirit, and if you start cooperating with Holy Spirit, it's like you are riding a wave of momentum and you are only going to head in one direction in your life, and it's the direction towards God the Father and towards Jesus. I believe that this is not just for some of us. I believe this is for all of us. I believe the Holy Spirit wants to be more influential in your life at work. He wants to be more influential in your family. He wants to be more influential in your thought life. He wants to actually be your counselor in your everyday. See, my daughter has shown me the power of influence it can have in life. You see, when she started at school this year, we went to one of her friend's parties, and she came up to me and she said, Daddy, I know what I want to do for my seventh birthday. Because when you're that age, you start planning birthdays 18 months in advance, because that's what little girls do. All right, so she's 5 and she's planning her 7th birthday because the 6th is already planned. All right, and she said, Daddy, I know what I want to do for my 7th birthday. I'm having a Katy Perry party. I go, no, you're not. And I mean, I actually like Katy Perry's music, don't get me wrong. Anyway, so I'm at this party and I just thought, I'll just leave it because hopefully she'll just get over her Katy Perry stage. And she'd never heard a Katy Perry song. Oh no, actually, she danced to the fireworks song, you know, Baby, You're a Firework? Is it Baby, You're a Firework? I don't know. It's the firework song. It's a good song. It's got good morals, good lyrics. But then we're at this kid's party and her friend from school walks in and we're sitting around, we're eating fairy bread and her friend walks in and she starts singing, I kissed a girl and I liked it. And for those of you who don't know, Katy Perry's first song was I Kissed a Girl and I Liked It. And this is Amari's very good friend. And I thought, wow, I hope Amari doesn't know that song. And then I thought, yep, Amari's not having a Katy Perry party. Anyway, just this year, through the influence of our kids' ministry and through in our car we have a DVD player, and we're like, no, we can't show the kids DVDs while we drive because that's bad parenting, except on long trips. But we'll let them watch praise and worship music because that's good parenting, right? Just thanks. Give me some encouragement. You don't have my kids. Who are you to judge me? You try dealing with them. And anyway, so we put like the Hillsong kids and the Bethel kids worship on. Anyway, Murray comes up to me. She goes, Dad, I've got a different idea for next year's, for my seventh birthday. I want to have a worship party. And I said, honey, I'm so proud. If Jesus returned right now, I would be so proud of you. And she goes, and Daddy, we could have, I'm not even embellishing. This is accurate. She said, Daddy, we could have a game where we all make microphones for each other. And we all have turns singing. And we can put it on the DVD player and we can all have turns singing. And I'm like, oh, honey, I couldn't love you anymore right now. And you see, the Holy Spirit wants to influence your desires. He wants to influence your passions. He wants to influence the way you think. He doesn't want to be an afterthought. He actually is. Imagine if Jesus was walking next to you and you ignored him day after day after day. That is what Holy Spirit wants to do. He wants to influence you. And that what this means is that there's a forceful momentum in your life. And it's the same momentum that's working our world. It's the momentum of the kingdom of God. It's the kingdom of righteousness and justice and mercy and love and goodness that is desiring to reign over injustice and brokenness and the hurtingness in our world. The momentum is overwhelmingly on our side. If God is for us, who can be against us? God will bring the work that he started in you to completion. This is the momentum of your life. You know, for some of you, I believe that you have been focusing on where you want to be in life. And because you're not where you want to be financially, because you're not where you want to be relationally, you're discouraged. But God would say to you today, you're not where you were. Where you used to be. You've actually moved from there. And you know what? You're not where you want to be, but that's okay because you are making progress. You're not where you used to be. You're not where you want to be, but you are making progress. Tell the person next to you that you're making progress. Because I believe that the enemy would have you think that you are so stuck in your ways that things can't shift, that things can't move. But I want to tell you, you don't have to make it happen in your own strength. If you just cooperate and listen and obey and trust Holy Spirit, you will move in the direction of the wave and you will grow. You see, in 2 Corinthians 3, let's read this together. 2 Corinthians 3, verses 16 to 18. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away, the veil that keeps us from God. For the Lord is Spirit, and wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord who is Spirit makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. Isn't that good? What it says is that because of the Spirit of God in us, He makes us more like Him. It's not about you trying to be a good Christian. It says that there is a momentum in your life. It's the Spirit of God, and He is making you more like Jesus. And it says, as we are changed, not that we might be changed. It says, as we are changed into His glorious image. That is the will of God. You don't have to think about it. God is taking you on a journey. You are not stuck. You're not where you used to be. You're not where you want to be, but you are moving in the right direction and you are making progress. And you don't have to make it happen in your own strength. You have to just stop resisting Holy Spirit. And you have to walk with Him. And you have to invite Him into the areas of your life that have been cut off for too long. What are the things that block the progress of the Holy Spirit in making us more like Jesus, in awakening us to the vision and mission of God for our lives and for the world. The first thing that blocks us is a defensive mentality. Being defensive, focusing too much on the politics in this world. If you engage emotionally in the politics of this country, the politics of the world, the politics of the United Nations, the politics of the United States, you will have a defensive mentality that you have to protect what's happening today because the world's gone mad. And you will focus on things that you cannot control. You will put all of your eggs in the basket of your opinion, but you can be that Christian that has really strong political and social opinions, but you live in such a way that you lose people. And so when the people in your life want help, they're not going to ask you for help because you're that person that rams your opinions down their throat. Nothing wrong with having an opinion. No one can take your opinion from you. But Jesus didn't go changing the world with his opinion. He demonstrated the love and power of the kingdom of God. And he proclaimed who he was and what he was going to do. He proclaimed the year of the Lord's favor. You see, I believe that we have a defensive mentality in whether it be there's the culture wars, generational bias, pessimism over the future of the church. We can get overly defensive and we're like a sports person. Whenever you see your sporting team and they're winning. Like I was watching my favourite Premier League team is Liverpool and I was up this morning watching it because my son was up at 3 a.m. And that's why I told you not to judge me about letting DVDs in my car before. And I was watching Liverpool and they were dominating, but then all of a sudden they became a little bit overly defensive. And I thought, they're going to lose this. They're going to lose. You know when your team, you just think, they're going to lose. They're getting overly defensive. Because the best form of defense is attack. You see, the church has been birthed to attack with love and justice and righteousness. Matthew 16:18, I tell you that you are Peter and on this rock I will build my church and the gates of hell will not overcome it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. You see, what it says is that not that the church needs to defend itself from the world, but the church is advancing. The church is like, there's this picture of the people of God advancing, taking ground, pushing back the kingdom of darkness, and that there's this little gate called the gates of Hades or the gates of hell that are trying to hold back the purposes of God. And what does Jesus say? The gates of hell will not hold back the purposes of God. So the purposes of God are not defensive, they are aggressive, but not in a violent way, but in a loving way, in a way that says that Jesus is Lord and the enemy is not. And Jesus is going to have his way in this world through his kingdom and through his church. Don't have a defensive mentality. Don't be that person that wins arguments and loses people. Don't focus on all the evil in the world and forget that you are light. The second thing is having a passive mentality. Some of us are overly defensive and combative, and some of us are just overly passive. Yeah, isn't it good? Jesus is going to return again. Oh, that's going to be a relief. Yep. It's good that I've got my ticket to heaven and I'm not one of those weird Christians, so I can still maintain my social standing and still have the best of both worlds. Yep, go to church once a fortnight, still do everything else and, you know, and I'm just going to coast on by. It's like the passive mentality. And what the problem with having a passive mentality is that that's not how the Spirit of God works in our lives. Very rarely in the Bible does God's Spirit ever take control of a human body and make a human do something that they don't want to do. Nearly always the Spirit of God works on the human heart and the human heart cooperates with the Spirit and by faith that human is able to do something she or he couldn't do before. I think many of us, I've said this a lot in recent times, we think that an experience with God is going to come through God enforcing or imposing himself on us. But a true experience of God is God saying, come and follow me. In the midst of following him, we experience life in a completely different way. That's the way it worked for the disciples. That's the way it worked for the apostles. That's the way it's worked in my life. And that's the way he wants you to experience, not being passive. Luke, this is my last scripture. Can I have keys up, please? Thank you. Luke chapter 10. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them out two by two ahead of him to every town and place where he was about to go. Isn't that good that he had 72 disciples? Do you know I like that? Because he had 12 disciples and then he had 72. So like the 12 were like the elite disciples. And then there was like the 72 more average disciples. I kind of think I would have fit in pretty well with the 72. That would have been more my crowd. But what I love about this is that even though they weren't the frontline disciples, Jesus has called them to not be passive, but to be people that demonstrate and live out his kingdom ministry. It says, verse 2, the harvest, he tells these guys, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I'm sending you out like lambs among wolves. When you enter a house, first say, peace to this house. If someone who promotes peace is there, your peace will rest on them. So these disciples that are going to homes and they're to proclaim peace because they are representatives of Jesus, the Prince of Peace. And the Spirit of Peace that we heard about before, wherever we go, whatever room we go into, we can know whatever dark situation, we take the light of God. It might just be a little candle, but let me tell you, a little candle has incredible ability to push back darkness. And when we walk into a room, we can bring peace. Some of you need to know that whatever situation, whatever hospital room, whatever classroom, whatever family situation, whatever situation in your neighborhood, you can be a peace bringer in that situation. Because the harvest is ready and God wants to send you out. It goes on to say, verse 8, when you enter a town and are welcomed, eat what is offered to you, heal the sick who are there and tell them the kingdom of God has come near. I like that because it messes with my theology because he says, before you preach, before you tell them about Jesus and the message of the kingdom, touch them. Touch them. Come near. Demonstrate that there is a new kingdom at work, a new priority at work, where people will reach out and bless and touch people that they don't even know, and that they will care enough to pray for and heal the sick before they even believe all the right things. Demonstrate the kingdom, and then after you pray for the sick, after you heal the sick, then preach the message of the kingdom of God and tell them that the kingdom of God is near. You see, these people, these disciples, these non-elite disciples are going into homes and they're walking into homes and they are saying, the kingdom of God is near. You know what people would have been thinking? Where's the king? Jesus wasn't there. They were the representatives of Jesus. And you are representatives of Jesus. You have the Spirit of God in you. So whatever room, whatever situation, whatever space you're in, where you go, you are someone that's bringing the kingdom of love, justice, mercy, righteousness, and power to that room, to that situation. The kingdom of God has come near. Can we stand to our feet?